Hey everyone, welcome back to the AI Coffee Break. Today we're diving into yet another fascinating ACL poster presentation. This one's all about graph language models. Have you ever wished you could take a powerful language model that excels at understanding text and apply it to processing a graph? Normally, you'd have to linearize the graph, which can cause the graph structure to get lost. Or you might use a graph neural network, but let's be honest, it's not exactly a powerful language model, right? Well, today's poster highlight might just be the solution. Moritz, a colleague of mine from Heidelberg, is introducing graph language models. These models essentially take a pre-trained language model and make it understand graphs and their underlying structure too. The only main requirement is that the language model used relative positional embeddings during pre-training or rotary positional encoding that most modern language models use. So let's sneak into Moritz's poster presentation now, where he breaks down the core ideas behind graph language models.
Our motivation was a video of graphs like this here, where we have these are kind of typical knowledge graphs where both the nodes and the edges have text. And if you look at an entire triplet, it's like black poodle is a dog, which is a normal sentence. So you want to use a language model for such kind of graphs just to encode the text. However, language models can't deal with graphs. So people typically like linearize the graph, putting one triplet after the other. And then you are kind of well equipped to deal with the text data, but the graph structure is not so well used. If people want to use the graph structure more, they commonly use language models to first encode the nodes and potentially the edges, and then use a graph neural network, which is good for graph reasoning, but the language understanding is kind of lost in this process. So we thought if we have one model which can do both the text understanding as well as the graph reasoning, it might be better at encoding such graphs. The way we do that is that we take a language model which has very good parameters for language understanding through all the pre-training, and we apply them to the architecture of a graph transformer, which brings the inductive bias for graph reasoning through the architecture, similar to a GNN. And this is what our graph language model is. You could also say that we take a graph transformer and we initialize it with the parameters from a language model. And then we have a model which can take in such graphs and give an encoding for both the nodes and the edges. To understand how we can do that in detail, we first have to look at the relative position encodings in normal text. So if you have a transformer, it kind of operates on a set of tokens without any structure. To change that for text, if you have a normal sentence like the dog chased the cat, and we look at how far away is dog from cat, we like 1, 2, 3. And we put that here in such a matrix, showing us dog is 3 tokens ahead of cat. And we give such a matrix to the model, and then the model has these relative distances, which encode the structure of the data. So to convert the language model to a graph transformer, we now need to convert this sequence structure here to a graph structure. The way we do that is that for triplets, tokens from the same triplet, like black poodle is a dog, we just have basically a normal sentence. So we just do what we hear, we just put the normal relative distances here. Same for dog as an animal, we do the same thing. However, if we look at cat, for example, and if we just follow the path, we would get dog is an animal, A is cat, which is not a natural language like sentence anymore, and therefore probably would not work well with our language model parameters. Therefore, we introduce a new relative distance here, namely graph to graph. That tells you that the two tokens are both in the graph, but we don't really know where right now. We either do that, or we simply omit these connections completely. Then dog does not directly attend to cat. However, as in a normal GNN, through message passing, it still gets impacted by the cat being here. This gives us a matrix like this here. And what we see here is, for example, the animal token has 2 left neighbors, as shown here in the graph. This never would happen in a normal text, but here this is how we can encode the graph structure. Basically, just allow to have two left or 2 right neighbors. We evaluate that on the task of relation classification. So we take a concepted subgraph like a graph here, and we replace a relation with a mask. And then the task is to predict the correct relation. We take the graph, we encode it, and we take the embedding of this mask token, and then we train a classification head on top of that, which gives us the final prediction. And we can do 2 things. We can either fine-tune both of them completely in a normal setting, or we can freeze the graph language model parameters and only train the classification head. In this setting, the parameters come from a language model, in our case T5, the encoder of T5, and we put them in a new architecture and we apply them to graphs, something the parameters have never seen before. This is what we do here in the linear probing setting. And we see that even then, the graph language model outperforms the graph linearization baselines, especially when graphs are larger or when we masked relevant parts around the graph. So we would like mask the neighboring concepts, making the graph structure more important. And we see that then the graph language model outperforms more. If we train the graph language model as well as the classification head, then we are in a normal fine-tuning setting here. And of course, the scores overall improve. And we see that for small graphs up to a radius of 3, actually the language model's baselines are better than our method. However, for larger graphs or when the graph structure is more important, then our method is better again. Another thing we can do with this model is to have both a graph as well as a separate text in there. So here we have the graph as before, and then here we encode the text as normally in the same model, same set of parameters. And we have a new relative distance again, namely graph to text and text to graph, such that the model can learn how much each modality should attend to the other one. And we apply that to basically the same task, but now we use Wikidata subgraphs as well as kind of aligned Wikipedia texts. And then we see that if you provide both modalities, the performance is best. And if you ablate either modality, the performance drops by a similar amount, meaning that the model uses both modalities.
If interested in the paper and the code for graph language models, find them linked in the video description below. Thanks for watching, and to enjoy your coffee breaks with our next videos, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe buttons.